any minor in nature, we still want to know about them, but by encouraging people to report them, pushes the figure up. And obviously you can't have both, but we'd rather have the higher minor reportable injuries rather than we don't hear about things until that minor injury becomes something a bit more serious. So it's just trying to balance those two areas.
Really. So there is a bit of an anomaly between the number of days lost, because if the number of incidents reducing, you'd expect the number of days lost to also reduce, but it's not comparable, really, is it? So I'll take up Councillor Connor's point and you'll hopefully address it.
I will take on more observation and yeah, I will work with that. Okay, thank you.
Very much.
Thank you. Given what you said about the increasing reporting culture, presumably that means the increase in the number of near miss reports. Presumably you see that as a good thing because people are choosing to report. Even where there hasn't been a negative outcome, they've decided to report it. And presumably we can then learn from that. And you can learn as much from a near miss perhaps as an actual accident itself.
Correct. I couldn't have said it better myself. What we are aware of, though, is that there are events that aren't reported, and I know certainly Paul Murphy, as my predecessor, has put a lot of work into increasing the awareness of near miss reporting and pushing that on another level this year. We've just had an upgrade in the health and safety software, and we've expanded it to safety observations as well. So there's always a debate about what's a near miss and what isn't. So we're going to take that question out by just saying, well, if you don't think it's a near miss, it's a safety observation. The more we know about it, the more we can identify where the trends are and hopefully impact and prevent any injury care before it goes. So again, what we will see is hopefully over the next 12 months a lot more reporting of minor incidents, but we can pick out of that the ones that may actually go on to the further consequences.
Can members agree the recommendation that we note the report? Okay, Guy Keane's going to talk us through the bonfire
day. Good afternoon, members. My name is Guy Keane. I'm the area manager with responsibility for Community Risk Management Directorate, which looks after a lot of the community risk campaigns. The bonfire period campaign being one of those significant ones for obvious reasons because of the risks and challenges we face at that time of year. And those that have followed our performance over a number of years will have seen that this is a big feature and has been for a number of years and has brought the number of incidents we've dealt with down quite considerably from what we've gone on in the past. And whilst it has reduced considerably, what we're certainly not being is complacent over it, hence why we feel it's important to bring this report to this committee so you can have the opportunity to scrutinise and review the performance over the 2017 period. The period itself runs from 19th of October to 7th of November, and in 2017 we had 392 calls over that period, which was 187 fewer than the previous year, so that's a reduction of 32%. That reduction was reflected across all districts, and Sefton had the largest percentage reduction decrease at 51.6% and 44 incidents. The Liverpool North had the largest overall reduction in actual incidents, and that went from 156 in 2016 down to 101 in 2017. During the bonfire period, we had 9 incidents of violence at work, which is something we take very seriously indeed. So whilst 9 is relatively low from what we've experienced in the past, it is still 9 too many, and that's the way we approach these. It was one less than 2016. However, if you look at the table of violence at work incidents, which is on page 172, just under paragraph 16, you'll see the list of incidents we've had there. Two that I would point out worthy of note, the third and fourth one, Kirby Tower Hill and off Chilwell Valley Road in Belle Vale, where it wasn't just that we had the incidents, but it was a higher level of violence at work. And I'm pleased to report that the intervention of Trojan, which we'll pick up at paragraph 22, was very effective in disrupting the second copycat incident of Belle Vale, which was an orchestrated pincer movement where youths surrounded a fire crew on both sides and to try and draw them into an ambush location. That was a little bit concerning, hence why we do collaborate very, very closely with the police in respect of trying to reduce these. If I take you back now to paragraph 9, over the 10-year average, this paints quite an interesting picture, and what you will see from the year 2008, and if we'd gone back, you would have seen that an increase in reduction in incidents, down to our lowest ever level in 2013, and then you'll see from that we did see increases over the next few years, and it's pleasing that we've now managed to reverse that trend and start to bring it back down again, but it is an area that will always take quite a high degree of effort and to work very closely with partners in order to make sure we continue having the impact that we do. Just to give you some insight into the sort of activities that take place to reduce those things down, we conducted 143 target hardening visits across the county of Merseyside. These were completed by our arson officers, and two of those were hate crime events. We had 124 fly tipping reports that were submitted by operational crews, and that material is taken off the streets. I have got a tonnage which I'll refer to later on in the report. We work very closely with partners, fire crews and our advocates to deliver presentations to schools right across Merseyside in order to help prevent some of the issues that we normally get, both in terms of the issues to the fire and rescue service and also to try and reduce the injuries. And you might have seen some of the footage where we went out on a local media and even had one slot on national television over fireworks injuries. So we haven't got the data from health yet, it takes a little bit longer to date, but as far as we're aware, we're very much down on the last year. We visited 54 locations to complete bonfire sweeps on the morning of the 6th of November, and this proved to be very effective in reducing the number of calls that have led to increases in previous years, and so that is something that we will take and extend that into 2018, but also look at increasing its capacity by the use of tipper trucks to make that sweep better again. If you look at page 171, just under paragraph 15, you'll see a breakdown of our incidents in comparison to 2016, and that shows it in actual numbers and in percentage terms. The following page, the violence at work, we've covered. Paragraph 17 looks at arson officers who this year were given ownership of their own plans to run multi-agency campaigns, working together closely with local partners and using local intelligence, and that proves to be very effective. In terms of equality and diversity, it's worth pointing out there is a correlation between the incidence of small antisocial fires and the indices of deprivation, and this also overlaps some of the areas that the police have not been, which increases demand for police as well. So that hence justifies the very close collaboration that we do with police and other agencies throughout this campaign. The calls, paragraph 20, calls constantly reviewed as well to make sure that we dealt with higher priority first, and that lines in with the service's commitment to take a risk-based approach to the way we mobilise our resources. In terms of legal implications, you're aware that we are responsible for explosive licensing, and we conduct a number of inspections over that period to make sure that the firework sales are done in accordance with the regulations. And I'm pleased to say that incidents that we've had in the past in respect to firework-related issues have remained low over this bonfire period. There's no financial implications arising from this report. Appendix A gives you a lot more detail. I won't go into that because I've already been through the highlights of it, but if you want more detail in respect of the data and also the breakdown on a district-by-district basis, you'll find a number of tables with data and also some maps of each local authority area which draw your attention to some of the specifics in the data that I've just summarised for you. Appendix B covers some infographics We've done the first page on 197 covers an overall for County Merseyside, which led to a 32% reduction in antisocial behaviour fires that we conducted. 132 drive-throughs on community risk management routes. These were routes that were identified as a collaboration of data from multi-agency partners, predominantly ourselves and police. We conducted 143 target hardening visits by our arson team. We had 9 violence at work incidents. We had 14 firework incidents. And overall, we removed just shy of 50 tonnes of bonfire material in the streets of Merseyside. And that is very much part of the reason why we had a reduction in those incidents. And any members would like to have a look at how that breaks down on a district by district basis. If you look at pages 198 right the way through to page 203, and you'll get a breakdown of those figures on a district basis, and that draws me to the conclusion of this report. Happy to take any questions.
Are there any questions on this, Councillor Rennie?
First of all, really, just to congratulate all our staff and our partner agencies. I mean, bonfire night now is not dreaded like it used to be by perhaps more miserable things in society, really, who don't actually enjoy it. And, you know, you can just hear yourselves, can't you? There isn't as much going on leading up to it. So, fantastic job, and the tonnage which is removed, again, you know, clearly goes towards reducing the antisocial behaviour. I know in the past, Guy, we've worked with agencies from across the country. I mean, you did allude to the legal implications of responsibilities under the explosive regulations of visiting premises. But we have in the past, and I just wondered if it's still ongoing, is trying to intercept some of the fireworks that are obviously coming in from foreign parts before they actually arrive in the area. Does that still go on?
No. Nowhere near to the same extent, but then again, we don't have the issues anywhere near to the same extent. But having said that, we're not complacent of it, and that is something that we regularly review and look into. And as a matter of interest, we're looking at adapting exactly the same methodology in order to tackle the growing issue of fires in waste and recycling centres. So, you know, that as a methodology does work, but there's a trigger point at which we will engage with our partners in order to deal with that. And it involves compiling all the holders of various pieces of legislation in order to enforce and also run them with disruption activities to prevent issues occurring in the first place. If I reflect back on years ago, and I saw this as an indication of success, one of the companies complained we were driving firework business out of Merseyside. That company was named after Prison Block, the owner of the company used to reside in. And so we weren't particularly sorry to see that business go. And because a lot of that business has moved on, we don't have the need to do the same level of multi-agency interventions that we did in the past.
Yes, thank you very much.
Any other questions? No. Can I just say a one-third reduction seems like a big win, so well done. I was going to ask a bit of a technical question. I like the maps. I think that breakdown is quite helpful. It's listed by super output area. Would it be possible to get the same data by lower super output area, which is just a different urban survey area? Do you have the data still, or was it done by a separate report?
We use John Fielding and Deb's team, who does all the analysis, and he that is very much what he's very good at. So I don't know if Deb, you're able to answer that question.
Yeah, I feel certain John Fielding will do something.
Which brings us to item 11. This is an exempt item, but if nobody, so I'm going to have to ask the press and public to leave at this point, if they could. Thank you.